August the 4th, 2016, we're in Macroom's historic castle grounds, also known as Macroom Domain. The word domain is an interesting word. It's a French feudal word coming from the Latin mensa, meaning a table. So the lord or the bishop depended on what he grew or what meat he raised within his walled or emparked domain, put food on his table. The outlying lands beyond the emparkment were tenanted, paying rent, but the domain was the food producer for the great house. There's about 200 acres here of the domain, emparked in 1607 by Lord Musgrave Viscount Cormac McCarthy. To empark land, you had to get a license from the Crown. It was known as propter decorum. To live in the English lifestyle, you had to live in a park. It was a method, it was the proof of your loyalty to the English throne by creating English parkland. A very popular tree in the 17th century and 18th century was the Spanish chestnut, also known as the sweet chestnut. This tree of over 6.5 meter circumference at shoulder height is very likely 18th century. It has stopped growing for over 25 years. I think we can say that after Cromwell confiscated all of the lands of Ireland and redistributed them, a family of Hedges came in and acquired Macroom Castle and Castle Grounds in 1707. It's very likely that the Hedges laid out the domain. I said to you earlier that the research from Myerscough Arboriculture College in Lancashire tells us that almost universally the newcomers to old domains and old parks left the old features alone. So we have here a medieval deer park, we have wood pasture, what's called wood pasture. These would have been preserved by Hedges. A very good example is Burr Castle. When the Parsons, or rather the Rosses, Lord Ross came in after the Cromwellian settlement, you can see all of the O'Carroll's woodlands and the O'Carroll inauguration oak still stands in front of Ross Castle in Burr. So that the newcomers, shall we call them, and the Williamites later, another generation after the Battle of the Boyne, a new wave of planters arrived in Ireland and created domains. We have about 1,000 domains in County Cork surviving. Domains or polite landscapes or designed landscapes. About 6,000 in all of Ireland's 20 million acres. There's still about 6,000 domains left. Now, that's a very small number because there would have been as many as 10,000 landlord families within their parklands in Ireland by the 1840s. We said earlier that the famine caused the great downfall of the big house. The tenants were starving, most of them emigrated, 1 million died, and the big houses fell into decline. The British government set up the Encumbered Estates Act in 1849 at the height of the famine, and thousands of Irish parklands were sold off to a new merchant industrial class of England who came over, and of course the first things to go were the trees and the parklands. Timber was very, very valuable in the 1850s and 60s. Luckily, the Hedges heirs never went bankrupt. They were allied to Muckross House in Killarney by marriage, and they were also by marriage connected with the 60,000 acre estate of Bantry House, the Whites. So through the Herberts and the Whites, the Hedges maintained a fairly robust axis. So these estates, luckily, fortunately for us, they never fell to the Encumbered Estates Courts and were not broken up. So these trees are left with us. Their importance now is ecological, of course. This tree is most likely hollow, very, very likely. Trees of this age, they naturally hollow out. So what is important is if you look up into the canopy, there's a lot of discernible dieback, dead wood. The tree is slowly retrenching. Retrenchment meaning that the battery, which is the root, is still pulling in the same amount of nutrients, but that with old age there is less of a spread of photosynthesis in the crown, so it is slowly, as we say, retrenching. It's over mature. It's an example of a post-mature veteran tree. This tree is a veteran. It meets all of the criteria for veteran trees. Not an ancient tree, but a veteran tree, post-mature. What's important about this stand of old sweet chestnuts in Macroom is the associated lichens, fungi, the diversity of mosses around these old trees. But also we know that there are owls moving house between a number of these sweet chestnuts. There's a very large bat population, mainly lazler bats, that feed over the canopy. And there are also what we call sapro, the Greek word for decay, saprophytic. Phyt is a Greek word for plant, botany is the new word. Phytology would have been the study of plants. But saprophytic, saprophytic fungi and bacteria, only known to colonize these very old trees, but also the insects associated with these very old pillars of nature. None of these are high mobile. So the biggest issue for most of Ireland's domains and parklands is lack of continuity habitat. Since independence and the compulsory acquisition in 1923 by the new state of many of the old domains and parks, we have not been planting. The state has been preoccupied elsewhere, obviously fighting a civil war and bankruptcy, etc. So the current research seems to be as a stopgap for these insects and the spores of these fungi, these rare fungi and bacteria that belong in veteran trees. The thinking now is alders, planting plenty of alders, not so much adjacent or adjoining, but within the zones of mobility of the invertebrates associated with these veteran trees. Alder enters decay quite early.
Okay.
And presents features very attractive to the biodiversity associated with very old veteran trees. So there's one, two.
Obviously these are much younger. Obviously.
These are much younger.
Yeah.
These are self-sown.
Okay.
Now some of them are planted. Now this one, the local environmental group planted this. This one here.
Right.
And this one here. But these are just self-sown.
Yeah.
And they established because the mowing machine, the management team, have not come in under these trees.
Because of the nature of it here, you just can't get at it, probably.
Can't get at it, and although there are deers have come up the River Ceylon, but they haven't chewed back anything here. BSB cut this big sweet chestnut here about 20 years ago. They brought power lines in.
Right.
That had to be cut. But it is now impossible for a chainsaw.
So if hard.
It is now utterly seasoned, reminding us that no tree was planted by the new landlord class after Cromwell or William or Elizabeth. Every tree had to have, they were working trees.
So, and these trees would have been, what would have been they were planted here for a purpose, so they had their working trees. So can you tell us what would have been
timber
for
the medieval German for to build, the verb timber.
Yeah.
Timber is a German word. So it was hugely valuable, timber.
And would it have been for house construction or naval construction?
More naval.
Right.
The sweet chestnut, some years ago near me, back near in Shkila, a large fine limb came down off a sweet chestnut about 10 miles away. And that day it was snapped up by a Swiss wood carver, wood turner, for £300.
Right.
Okay. One limb. So it was the shape of the limb that our friend had his eye on.
Okay.
But also embellishment. Remember, the castle, old Macroom Castle, is about 300 metres away, facing up into the domain or parkland. And this was embellishment, the creating of polite landscapes.
So decorative kind of addition to the landscape.
Very much. Yeah. That class lived in a world of decor.
Right.
They
right.
lived in that world. And we're very fortunate that with the passage of time, these old dears have come down into our care.
Right.
And to remind us, I remember 50 years ago, I heard Nelson's Pillar being blown up.
Mm.
And I was even at that time, I was only a young teenager in a boarding school near the city centre. But I remember being aware that there was something very wrong had happened.
Mm.
So these trees, they are monuments to a past
historical markers.
They're historical,
historical markers.
And under Irish, under autonomous rule, since we got independence, at least in Macroom here, a lot of the old trees dating back to the imperial, colonial period, they're still here.
Yeah, because there was a tendency to, a bit like Nelson's Pillar, to kind of obliterate everything that was associated with those, with the planter, with the English.
Landlord.
Even though they weren't part of our native ecosystem, and they're not an ancient tree, they're still significant, even from an ecological perspective, you're saying.
They're a form of woodland.
Yeah, they're still a form of woodland.
Parkland is a form of woodland. I've been reading Rackham, Oliver Rackham, on Parklands recently. And the Native Americans probably were the earliest to develop what is now hunting parkland. They cleared the under canopy, the shrub layer, of woodland, and opened it up for chase and hunting.
So it gave them access, if you like.
Gave them access, but also made it attractive to the wild meat.
Right, for the grazers and stuff that come in.
Grazers. The Romans practiced hunting and deer parking, or rather wood pasture. Now, wood pasture is probably the oldest.
Yeah, and wood pasture is, can you just explain that briefly?
Well, wood pasture is where domestic livestock, cattle, horses, sheep, goats and so forth, they grazed the park.
Right.
The parklands.
Yeah.
But they had woodland for shade and shelter in the winter and in the autumn.
Okay.
It was a form of wood pasture.
So they'd be roaming in around the trees, they'd be grazing in between the trees, like kind of a bit like what you see here. And they'd graze in between the trees, but still there were these trees growing. What we see as pasture now is a bit like what we see down here is glorified lawn, basically.
Yes.
For grazing. So,
yes.
So there was that biodiversity going on.
That biodiversity was going on.
Yeah.
And also, Diana Burford reminds us that cattle are a verge of the forest species. They're not a grazer, they're a browser.
Mm. Mm.
And therefore, the presence of woodland, as Diana would say, no species loses its genetic memory of nature. So hedgerows that we'll come on to soon are so important because it recreates the aboriginal habitat in the memory of our livestock.
And they tend to accumulate around hedges and around trees as well.
They do.
I've noticed, yeah.
They do. Certainly in a north wind under the cold, wet pelt of a November hill, the livestock are in under the trees and under the hedges. And I remember one vet told me some years ago, one of the biggest killers, there was no death certs issued for cattle in Ireland till the last 15 years. So there was no record of why cattle were dying. One vet suggested the largest killer of cattle in Ireland was sunstroke.
Right, yeah.
Sunstroke. But also rabbits were introduced by the Romans into Britain, and then the Normans brought rabbits, pheasant, sika deer. Britain has two species of deer native, roe and red deer. We only have one native species, of it's red deer.
Hmm.
But the McCarthys from the early 1600s, they brought deer in here, and they had a deer park. And then in the 1656 Down survey, we find that instead of deer, Lord Musgrave has filled his park with sheep, and there are many orchards in Macroom Castle grounds. So he obviously practiced a form of open orchard with sheep grazing through the orchards,
okay,
which was a form of deer park.
Yeah,
except
just
sheep.
Sheep
was...
which again would have been an imported species as well, wouldn't it?
Sheep were brought in the early Neolithic period. So wool would have been important, and it was commercial.
Yeah.
There was a commercial interest behind the embellishments of these parks.
So I suppose their relationship with the land would have been one of commerce rather than anything else, would it?
It would have been one of commerce. Mm. We don't really see the colony settling down till they begin to plant avenues about the 1760s. The Cromwellian and Elizabethan families were still very unsettled. The wolf, the wolf here.
They were mobile for understandable reasons, I suppose. They were still, it hadn't been, Ireland, I suppose, let's say, hadn't been completely colonised.
It hadn't yet been reduced. Hmm. It was after a beautiful plaque in Fota House, the house of the Smith Barrys, who I knew the last of them, Evie Petherick. But a plaque shows King William on his white horse, William of Orange, William, Reducer of Ireland. So it wasn't until after the Treaty of Limerick in 1691 that the earlier settlers began to settle down. But still there were white boys, there were Tories, there were Woodkern.
Mm.
Eileen McCracken suggests as many as 20,000 armed Irish infantry still inflicting guerrilla warfare on the new estates and the new domains. But certainly by the 1760s, they now had settled and began to plant avenues, as we're going to see now.
And could I just ask you one question on that? The Woodkern, I think Elizabeth I said that, I think if I'm correct, she said to basically get rid of the woodlands, or what the forest, as we would probably call it, the original forest, and you get rid of them. So these woodcarns who were carrying out guerrilla warfare, they'd come in, they'd strike, they'd leave, they'd disappear into the forest. Does that imply then that later that forest was gone? Or would I be correct in saying that?
Well, the only royal park, one quarter of England was royal forest owned by the Crown. But there's only one royal park in Ireland that I know of, that's Phoenix Park. So that it came under the royal hunting.
Right.
Hunting was a major pastime of the Norman Plantagenets. Now, we have a record of Blennerhassett writing, I think, from Ballyseedie in Tralee, addressing Elizabeth I, asking for permission to clear out the old woodlands and forests. But Elizabeth said no. These woods would be required for the new British Navy. Because Catholic Europe was building its navies, Portugal, France and Spain, and Britain was falling behind.
Right.
And needed oak. But also oak for barrelling provisions for the new colony in America. Most of the provisioning of the North American English colony was barreled in Irish oak. We have a record of that. So again, there was commerce. But in fairness, Elizabeth said, no, hold on. Careful, careful. Do not clear fell the forests. But the bounty for wood kerns increased.
Right.
So, I mean, we find in Elizabeth's time that the volume of money placed on the head of the Earl of Desmond was such a large sum of money that the native Irish competed with the Elizabethans for his head. I think it was 100 guineas.
Right. It sounds like a similar situation that prevailed in North America with the scalping. And I think it was the British or the French brought in the same system there, that they paid per scalp. I think it was, I'm not suggesting scalping was going on in Ireland or that Elizabeth was encouraging it, but it seemed a similar kind of process, though, was it?
An ethnic cleansing.
An ethnic cleansing.
Yeah.